symbol of excellence in sports entertainment.
I'm Gorilla Monsoon.
I'm Lord Alfred Hayes.
Hello, everyone, and welcome to Primetime Wrestling. As you can obviously see, the weasel, Bobby the Brain Heenan, not with us here this week for a number of reasons, and we're going to explain to you in just a moment what all those reasons are. He's in deep trouble, Alfred.
He really is.
You know, he's a type of individual who I'm sure never realized for one moment that running his mouth could give him a sore neck.
What?
So to speak.
That's one way of putting it, a very nice way.
But he's been in a lot of trouble in the last few months here in the World Wrestling Federation with all the things that have gone down, starting right with the results from WrestleMania, and then all the things that transpired up to the present point in time where he is not with us. Whether he'll be back with us next week or not remains to be seen. We don't really know how serious the condition that he is in is.
No, it's been a very unhappy period for him, I must admit.
Well, it's been a joy to a lot of other people. We still have a very outstanding and interesting program here this week with our feature, of course, from Madison Square Garden, the Tag Team Elimination Battle Royal, a one-of-a-kind event, most unusual, where anything and everything can and does happen, and these are dangerous-type matches, Alfred.
They're even more dangerous than just an ordinary battle royal.
Yeah, they certainly are. But the thing that strikes me in my mind is that once you're eliminated, whoever your partner is also gone as well.
Yeah.
But getting back to the Heenan situation, we're going to take you right now to all the interesting effects that led up, all the things that went down, the situations that occurred, to what's going on right now.
You know, in recent weeks, we've reviewed the fantastic amateur career of Ken Patera. Now, it was a long road from Portland, Oregon, to Brigham Young University, to the Olympics, and finally to the World Wrestling Federation, and then to the road to disaster.
What was it like sitting in jail, being in prison? The disgrace I brought upon my loved ones, my family, my friends, the disgrace I brought up myself. I hope to make it right.
Ken Patera leaves little doubt who is responsible for his misfortune.
Everybody gave up on me, Heenan, including you. You sold me down the river. Nobody thought I could make a comeback. But I'm back, Heenan, and I'm back for good.
Naturally, Bobby Heenan has vehemently denied any responsibility for what happened to Ken Patera.
And I'm going to set the record straight now. I had nothing to do with what happened to this man. Anything he earned in this career, anything he got in professional wrestling is because of me, my mind, my attitude, and the way I directed him. What he did outside that ring is his business. He is a grown adult.
Well, those are all the interesting things that led up to what's coming up here in just a moment. Bobby Heenan actually went out and challenged Kenny Patera to a debate. In fact, first time ever in the history of the World Wrestling Federation and professional wrestling in general that this type of event took place.
I was rather surprised that Patera accepting that, because it's well known that Bobby Heenan is very slick with his tongue.
Well, Kenny Patera has been all over these United States and all over the world, doesn't have to take a back seat to anybody. So let's go to debate. Let's go to Mean Gene Okerland right now.
Ladies and gentlemen, you are part of history in the making. You are eyewitness to the first ever televised wrestling debate. Ladies and gentlemen, before I introduce the principals, I would like to explain the ground rules that will adhere for this debate. First of all, both men will be given equal time for opening comments. They will be given equal time to state their respective cases along with the appropriate rebuttal. And finally, they will be given equal time for closing comments. At this time, I would like to introduce the principals for this debate. To my right, from Beverly Hills, California, Mr. Bobby Heenan. And to my immediate left, former U.S. Olympian from Portland, Oregon, Ken Patera. Gentlemen, I will be keeping time. I'll watch that time very carefully. We will commence with the opening comments. And with that...
I'll start.
Wait a minute. I'll conduct this.
I'm going to go first.
For opening comments, we will start with you, Mr. Heenan. You may begin.
First of all, it is a disgrace for a man of my stature and what I've accomplished and done in professional wrestling to have to stand in the presence of a man who should be locked away and have the key thrown away. A man like you. I'm talking to you, ex-con.
All right, Mr. Heenan. Now for your opening comments, Mr. Patera. You may begin.
Let me tell you something, Heenan. I'm proud to live in a country that when a man makes a mistake, he can pay for it. He can pay his debt to society and leave it all behind him. I paid my debt. Furthermore, I'm proud of my amateur record. I'm proud of the fact that I competed in the Olympic Games in Munich, Germany for the United States of America. I'm also proud of the fact of my professional record. I'm glad to have the opportunity to return to the World Wrestling Federation.
All right, I thank you, Mr. Patera. We will give you an opportunity for rebuttal, but first of all, Mr. Heenan, here is your opportunity to state your case. You may begin.
You listen up, ex-con, and you listen good. I'm gonna tell you something right now that I haven't dreamed up. It's nothing just coming out of my mouth. It is a... Because Patera should be kept behind prison walls. Why? Why should he be kept behind prison walls? It's because Patera is a vicious and violent animal. You don't believe me? Quote, you read it.
That's it. That's it. All right, Ken Patera, on the heels of those comments, we're going to give you opportunity for your rebuttal, your retort.
Listen here, Heenan. Like I stated before, I'm glad I live in a country that gives a man an opportunity to pay his debt to society. I have paid that debt. I'm through with it. And one other thing that I'm glad I'm through with is you and your weasel family.
Mr. Patera, at this juncture, I'm going to give you the opportunity to state your case. Mr. Patera, begin.
As I was sitting in prison, weasel, I had a lot of time to think of the Bobby Heenan types of this world. Types like yourself. As I needed moral support, which you granted me, you said that you were going to stand behind me 110%. Nothing was going to go wrong. As I sat in that courtroom during that 7 days of trial, you were never there. You never showed your face. Then as I was sitting in the cell, in a prison cell, not one phone call, not one letter, not one visit. You had completely abandoned me, Heenan, when I was down on my luck, wondering what next. He had to have made some kind of contact, maybe with my family. So I called my wife. I talked to my children. Have you heard anything from Bobby?
They said, no, not even a phone call, not a letter, nothing. You had completely abandoned me, which was completely against what you had stated earlier.
All right, I thank you. And now, Mr. Heenan, for your rebuttal. You may start.
First of all, ex-con, I want you to get something straight. And you listen up real good. I'm a businessman. I'm not a babysitter. And what you do outside the ring, big, big ex-con punk, it's your business, not my business. My job is to get you booked in that ring. And as far as calling your wife and your two snot-nosed kids, I could give a damn.
All right, gentlemen. Finally, we have come to the point in the debate where we're going to give you an opportunity to summate. For your closing comments, we will begin with you, Ken Patera. You may start.
Well, like I stated earlier, Heenan, I'm proud to live in the United States of America. I pay my debt. That's behind me. I'm proud of my amateur record, the blood, sweat, and tears that I poured out in the gym every day to represent the United States of America in the Olympic Games. I'm also proud of my professional record. But there's one thing that I have left to do, something that's going to make me very, very proud. And that is to rid the world of the scum like you, Weasel!
All right. Mr. Heenan, we're going to allow you time for your closing comments. You may begin.
You're not going to walk right up the ladder to the World Wrestling Federation top if I got to get every member of my family and make sure you're mentally, physically, and financially busted. I'll do it. All you ever concerned yourself with was pressing weights, and all you're good for now is pressing license plates. Well, I'll tell you something, pal. You never brought me a championship. You never brought me nothing. All you wanted was a title. All you wanted was a belt. You want a belt? You want a belt? I'll give you a belt.
Can't believe it. Bobby the Heenan asked for it. And boy, I'll tell you, he got it.
Did you see what Patera did to him? He put the belt around and snapped him across the ring.
Look at that. Everywhere. What an ovation. Ken Patera, Bobby the Brain Heenan. We'll be back as we continue. Stay with us.
Wow. Talk about being hung out to dry. Bobby the Brain Heenan was indeed. Kenny really got to him verbally, Alfred, because I don't believe that in his right frame of mind, Heenan would ever attack Ken Patera physically.
No, that's what came out of this was, in fact, I was wrong. I would have thought that the slickness of Bobby Heenan's tongue would have easily rattled Patera. However, it didn't, and then Bobby resorted to physical
tactics. Yeah, he really got bent out of shape, and now his neck is really bent out of shape. The diagnosis immediately or shortly thereafter was his sprained neck. I imagine he'll be hanging around the living room for quite some time, but he got exactly what he deserved after the way that he treated a man who was in his stable.
Yes,
by completely ignoring him in a situation time when he really needed someone to stand up for him. He just wasn't there.
Severely sprained neck is a lot there.
Well, maybe we'll see and hear from Bobby the Weasel. Maybe we won't. Right now, let's take a look at where the WWF is coming.
the World Wrestling Federation On Tour, coming to these great areas and facilities with action. Saturday, May 9th, Philadelphia, Pennsylvania, Philadelphia Spectrum, the Honky Tonk Man among those in action in Philadelphia. Friday, May 8th, Richfield, Ohio, Richfield Coliseum, the champion Hulk Hogan with a title defense in Richfield. Friday, May 8th, Springfield, Massachusetts, Springfield Civic Center, Nikolai Volkoff, Danny Davis among those in Springfield. Thursday, May 7th, Cincinnati, Ohio, Riverfront Coliseum, the Birdman, Coco Beware, among those on the card in Cincinnati. Thursday, May 7th, West Palm Beach, Florida, West Palm Beach Auditorium. You'll see among those on the bill in West Palm, George the Animal Steele. Wednesday, May 6th, Evansville, Indiana, Robert Stadium Arena, Ricky the Dragon Steamboat on the card in Evansville. Wednesday, May 6th, Tampa, Florida, the University of South Florida Sun Dome, the Hart Foundation title defense in Tampa. Be a part of the great World Wrestling Federation action when it comes to your area.
Chocolate lovers, watch out for new Choco Bliss.
Oh, what a sweet sensation. Oh, watch this, what you do to me, do to me. New Choco Bliss, a chocolatey creation. Three layers make it so chocolatey. Moist chocolatey cake, whipped chocolatey fill it to chocolatey icing so smooth. Choco Bliss, a dream come true.
One, two, three.
I'm relaxed to see.
New Choco Bliss from Hostess. Watch out.
Oh, hi, Vern. Your buddy Ernest has to hurry and finish packing.
With the canvas, he's over in his own corner and tags in Jim Evans. Evans, 216 pounds. Kelly, 288. Oh, a clothesline.
We're back, folks. George the Animal Steele going to start things off for us here this week, wrestling-wise. We're going to see a whole lot of more action, including Outback Jack later on in the program. Jumping Jim Brunzel, one half of the Killer Bees against one half of the Hart Foundation, Jim the Anvil Neidhart. Also going to take a look at Demolition, one of the most powerful teams to enter the World Wrestling Federation in quite some time, would you not say, Alfred?
I think they're immensely powerful and very, very forbidding.
Right now, let's go to Toronto's Maple Leaf Gardens. George the Animal Steele taking on Luscious Johnny V.
Picking up from New York City, weighing 260 pounds, Luscious Johnny V. His opponent, about to make his way to the ring, from Detroit, Michigan, weighing 285 pounds, George the Animal Steele.
Originally, George the Animal Steele scheduled to wrestle here in Toronto's Maple Leaf Gardens tonight, the Honky Tonk Man. Gorilla Monsoon at ringside here with Billy Red Lions. And obviously, something physically wrong with the Honky Tonk Man, and he being replaced by Luscious Johnny V, the manager of the Dream Team. Although right now, there's a whole lot of trouble in the Dream Team stable. A lot of dissension in the ranks as George is unloading. And there goes Luscious Johnny V. To the outside, looking to regroup as the most unpredictable man in professional wrestling sends him a reeling.
And that Luscious Johnny V had agreed to fill in for him.
This is a very devious person, Billy Red. And
yes, you know, this Honky Tonk Man, I don't know, you know, he couldn't tell the truth of his life depended on.
Obviously deathly afraid of George the Animal Steele. Where on earth is the Colonel, in fact?
That's right, Colonel Hart
to the south, Jimmy Hart.
Very mysterious that he is not here tonight.
Strange happenings here in Toronto's Maple Leaf Gardens as capacity crowd on hand. Sellout earlier on in the week for this extravaganza of the World Wrestling Federation. Gorilla Monsoon here at ringside with Billy Red Lions. We've had a substitution here. Luscious Johnny V out of New York City filling in for the supposedly injured Honky Tonk Man.
Well,
I didn't get any injury report, Red.
Neither did I. And, you know, I think you hit it on the head. The nail on the head, I should say, earlier when you said you think the Honky Tonk Man, and it boils down to the truth of the matter, is that he's afraid of George the Animal.
The Animal now finally caught up to the Luscious one, and look, he's trying to take a chunk out of the forehead of Johnny V. Slam right in the center of the ring. Look at that. What's Honky doing? He just stripped that thing off of his arm. Look at that. Nothing wrong with that arm whatsoever.
Absolutely not. You call this one right. You know, he was afraid of George the Animal Steele. That's all it was.
Look at that back jumper right there, now stripping off the bandages that he obviously didn't need. And now look at that. Oh. Obviously something hard, some cast-like material inside there. And now both he and Johnny B doing a number on George the Animal Steele. And the chant goes out for JYD. I don't know if the junkyard dog is anywhere in sight. Talk about despicable displays. We've seen one here in a complete making a fool, trying to make a fool out of everyone, the Honky Tonk Man.
Well, I can guarantee you one thing, Gio, this Honky Tonk Man, he's gonna pay for this, believe me. You haven't seen the end of this one.
Look at this now. Oh, there goes the referee as these two continue their onslaught. We're gonna need some help here from the back area, some way, shape, or form, although we're not, as the Animal comes to life, and he's got a hold of Johnny B.
But boy, they did a number on George. Yeah, he certainly did.
And he's going right back to the dressing room, chasing them, but they're long gone. I'm sure that we've had a disqualification here for outside interference.
Had to be, no other way.
And I'm sure there'll be some heavy fines inflicted for putting their hands on the referee as well. That's what we get the official word.
The referee's decision. Luscious Johnny V has been disqualified. The winner of the match, George the Animal Steele.
Well, George getting his hand raised in a token of victory, but I'm sure he's not satisfied with that. He's inside that ring and he wants more. He wants this to continue.
Well, George the Animal Steele, I'm sure, Alfred, not happy with that kind of a victory. A real stand-up guy, the Honky Tonk Man. Always yes. Ready to jump somebody from behind, like he did to Jake the Snake Roberts when he clobbered him with his guitar from behind. What real stand-up guy, the Colonel. The Colonel obviously has a lot of input there.
Another thing that really surprised me was the speed of Johnny V. He could really run, could he not?
Scared to death. Scared to death of George the Animal Steele. I don't know too many guys who get in the ring with George the Animal Steele and don't come out with a negative attitude.
No, very few these days.
He can give that to you. He's very unpredictable, very powerful, very ring-smart individual.
He is, and he's impervious to pain or punishment. He
doesn't
just
seem to be too much you can do to him to slow him down. There's a whole lot of things you can do to guys like the Weasel to slow them down. In fact, he slowed down considerably over the weekend, and we're still waiting for some further reports as to the actual physical damage done by Kenny Patera in that special debate. So far, all we know is a sprained neck. We'll be right back with Outback Jack in just a moment. Unique wrestlers have found their way here to the World Wrestling Federation. I think the next gentleman coming up certainly resembles that remark, Alfred. I'm talking about Outback Jack.
I thought that's who you were talking about. He's traveled a long way to achieve what he wants to make for himself in the World Wrestling Federation. I think he's going to make a very, very strong showing here.
Well, I think he may be a little bit disappointed that he doesn't find any of his friends here, any of his Aborigine friends, or some of the things he's used to in Australia. Right now, let's go to ringside for Outback Jack as he takes on Frenchy Martin.
At the present time, the gentleman weighs 245 pounds. From Quebec City, Frenchy Martin.
Ken, this is the first visit to Philadelphia Spectrum that I'm aware of.
And his opponent, making his way to the ring.
That music in the background, Dick, can mean only one man, the gentleman from Down Under.
Outback Jack!
Fans here awaiting the appearance of the man from Honky to Australia, Outback Jack. What a popular wrestler he has become here in such a very short time.
Is there really a Honky to Australia?
That there is.
I'm not going to argue with the man.
There's living proof of it right there.
Look at that jacket. Now that's something else. Maybe we get a shot of that. Yeah, there you go.
I'm not exactly sure what that is on the back. But
looks like a small alligator, yeah. Hey, he's a crowd pleaser.
Oh, no question. They love him. As popular as they come.
Frenchy Mark not too thrilled about all this outside the ring.
I think it's a little bit of a psychology here. Frenchy Martin in the ring. He's willing, wanting to get this battle underway. And Outback Jackson holds up a finger and says, just a minute, I'm not finished this ring with my fans here at the Spectrum. I'll be there sooner or later. And you can see it's getting the dander of Frenchy Martin up. He's a little perturbed.
This could work against a guy like Martin if he has a short fuse. Let's see how cool he is. This guy comes ready. Out Jack back. Look at the boots on this guy.
He looks like he's a very tough looking 280 pounds. He looks like with that size, Dick, he could be a little perhaps closer to the 300 pound mark.
Right, your preliminaries here. Joe Morello, the referee, talking to Outback, and Martin wants no part of it. Here's the bell, so we're underway. What is this, boxing?
Outback Jackson, so I'll go anywhere you want to go.
Yeah, he says, I'll do it with him.
I think he's a big old straight fighter from down under.
So the ringsider's on the case of Frenchy Martin already.
Outback Jack showing his pleasure. Frenchy Martin's had kind of a tough night. He hasn't had a chance to even hook up with Outback Jack yet, and I don't think that's going to be any picnic either.
Frenchy Martin is barely off the plane into the Spectrum. He says, hey, what are they on my case for? I just got here.
Now Martin turns him around and will ring around the rosy.
Well, they got a break there off the on the rope. All right, there's a clean break, more or less.
Clean bait by Outback Jack, but I like the fact that he broke very cautiously, keeping an alert.
So the fans of ringside are on Martin, calling a greaseball. I think if he moves in their direction, they might back away.
It's definitely not the dry look on Frenchy Martin, I can tell you that.
That's for sure.
Now, call it elbow. Frenchy Martin's trying to drive Outback into the ring, but Outback Jack showing him the strength behind that 280, 300-pound body, and Frenchy Martin a little arm drag takedown.
Well, you got about 35-pound differential between Outback back and Frenchy Martin.
Frenchy Martin's got to be thinking now the crowd doesn't like him. He's had two quick confrontations with Outback Jack and ended up on his keister both times.
Got to tell you something. He's in bad part of town. Yeah, look, guy looks like he's ready to fight or wrestle, anything else, whatever you want to do.
Coming from the Outback in Australia, it's probably the way they do it. They get together, and if they're going to fight, you take the rule book, toss it out the window, and who's ever left standing at the end walks away.
And he buys. Whoa, nice maneuver, took him down. And again, body slam coming up.
You saw the power of Outback Jack. Frenchy Martin walked right in. Outback picked him right up and slammed him down. And Frenchy says, enough of this for the moment.
I'm going to bail out. I'm going to think this thing out of it.
Well, he's giving up size. He's giving up strength. Giving up height. And he may even be giving up quickness. And Frenchy Martin about now has got to be wondering why he bothered to come to the Spectrum tonight.
He said, I should have missed the plane. Fans are really relentless. They're on his case like crazy.
Very popular Outback Jack. And speaking of popular, there'll be 90-plus thousand at the Silverdome in Pontiac, Michigan, Sunday afternoon, March 29th. The largest indoor crowd ever. And the reason, it's WrestleMania 3. And if you can't make your way to Pontiac, you can see all the action right here at the Spectrum on giant closed-circuit big screen.
Well, the big guy literally picked up Frenchy Martin, placed him on the top rope right at the turnbuckle. Now he's getting a few warnings by Joe Morello. Frenchy said, wait a minute, I'm walking away from this. Why, he grabbed my tights and all kinds of stuff. Frenchy says, he's not treating me well. The fans are saying, who cares?
Referee Joe Morello is a little too smart to buy that routine and didn't even bat an eye.
Morello warning Outback Jack to open up the fist.
Now suddenly Frenchy wants to make friends. He wanted no part of it early on, but the way the going has been, he suddenly wants to be pals with Outback Jack as he drops to his knees.
Outback Jack's no.